Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Triforce Podcast. Today, coming from massively pollen-filled England, where I am like a snot machine, apparently, because, I don't know, I don't normally get hay fever, but it's like we've had like a thunderstorm, and I think that like throws everything up in the air, all the pollen.
Yeah.
Sips, how are you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
I just told you. P-Flax, how are you doing?
Doing great.
Okay, good. Welcome back, everyone. So, as you can hear outside in P-Flax's garden, the lowly call of a wood pigeon.
Yes, you might hear the of the pigeon.
Yes.
Who lives in my garden. Now, I've got, there's a few trees, sort of not on my, in my garden, but around it.
Right.
And there was these two wood pigeons, a lady pigeon and a man pigeon, and they lived in this big tree in my neighbor's garden. Like, it was a big, big tree. It was like four-story tree. I don't know what it was. It was kind of like an evergreen. It was some kind of evergreen tree anyway.
A spruce, maybe?
Something like that. But it was a nice tree, but they had it trimmed.
Right.
Because it was getting really tall. So if they came and they basically, these guys just came in and just cut the tops off the tree, which kind of surprised me. It just went like that. So they're all,
yeah.
It was a shame because it was a beautiful tree. But anyway, it'll be back, I'm sure. And the pidgeys lived in there, but then they had to move. Because obviously their house got destroyed.
They did surgery on your tree.
They did, yeah.
They're tree surgeons. They're
very
careful.
Yeah, but it felt
people.
Like they literally just cut it in half. Like, it, normally with a tree surgeon, I always feel like they trim the branches that are hanging out all crazy.
Scalpel.
But with this one, they just went straight across the top. Like,
clear.
Exactly. So they moved to the tree behind my house, which is, I don't know, sycamore or something like that.
Right.
Which is the one that drops the little spinny helicopter guys.
You think that that's an upgrade for them over the spruce?
I don't know. I didn't think so. It's not as nice. The whatever the sprucey thing was, it was really bushy. And it actually looked like it would be kind of cozy in there.
You know? Right.
It was like, it was lots of thick foliage on it. Whereas this one, obviously, it's a bit more of a regular tree. So it's got some branches and stuff like that. It's a little bare, a little bit more
bare. Did they
have
to shave it first before they did the surgery?
No, they didn't. They just went in.
Wow.
I mean, it's an amputation. If you're going to cut someone's leg off, you don't carefully shave the leg first. I guess you just go, blip, and that's it. So they're chopping the legs off the top of this tree.
If I was a surgeon, I'd be like, you know, I'd take a little cheeky opportunity to shave the area.
You would?
Yeah. Why not?
My mate recently had a vasectomy.
Wow.
And he had to have his balls shaved.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
The guy said, everything below the penis must be shaved. And I'm thinking, that's pretty much everything you need to worry about, unless you've got like a really hairy dick.
See, I always thought that I'm too scared to shave my balls because they're really hairy. And
we talked about this.
You know,
it's
there's
going to
be some cutting or something. But if you're going for surgery and they have to shave your balls, I think that's the best chance that you have to maintain shaved balls, right? Because they're already
shaved. I'm not sure I'd want to. I'm happy with a little bit of hair on the balls. I mean, need to walk around with a Sean Scrotum.
Yeah, I mean, unless the guy has a dick that looks like that Muppet with the long nose and a massive
Gonzo.
Head of hair.
Gonzo.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah.
Big Gonzo dick.
With the shock of hair kind of just everywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, hang on a second. Who has like hair all over, like Gonzo hair all over his nose? Like not necessarily. Necessarily thick, bushy hair,
hair
but like
all
just
over
downy.
Your shaft and everything too, because he's got like a furry nose, doesn't he?
I guess some dudes do, because the surgeon was very specific. But you have to do it yourself. And the surgeon leant over to my mate and said something. He said, "Now, whatever you do, don't try using an electric trimmer, because I've seen some terrible accidents
on your balls."
And I thought, "Oh
on
my
your
god,
balls?
Yeah."
Okay.
So you know, like I use an electric trimmer on my head. It's like a hair trimmer.
Right.
I use that. And he was like, whatever you do, don't use that. Because you'd be tempted to just go, I'll just run it down. But it's not a smooth surface.
So what, you just use like just a straight up Bic on your balls?
I think, yeah, you get, I mean, he got, he was very careful. You can get, I mean, think about this. Women shave their parts all the time, man.
I know, but
so
like,
you don't shave against the grain though, right, apparently.
No, you never do that anyway.
It's gotta be.
Anyone that shaves against the grain is a Goomba.
But sometimes it's quite difficult to know, I mean, on your balls, like. Which,
well, I think you just go with it.
Right.
Just go with it
just
and
go
just
with
get it.
It
as short as
just
you can.
Go
yeah.
with it.
So
just
with the whole shave against the grain thing, did your dads teach you that? Or were you guys like me and did you learn that from watching Lethal Weapon?
A little bit of both, I think, because my dad wasn't around when I learned to shave, right?
Right. So Lethal Weapon was your
tutor. Yeah, I think
it was
actually tutor. Lethal Weapon. Yeah, it was a big
was
thing.
Was your dad. Yeah. That's a nice story.
Fucking Murtaugh, Sergeant Murtaugh. I'm too old for this shit. Damn it, Riggs!
Which one would you say was more your dad?
Riggs. Not Riggs, Murtaugh.
Murtaugh was an actual dad in the movies, whereas Riggs was just a fake dad. You know, he was like...
He was a guy you'd think, wow,
like
he's cool.
A lot like you, Lewis. He turns up for the good times and then he gets to sleep at night when he goes
and
home.
And he's insane and suicidal.
But isn't that more of the cool... Isn't that what you'd want as a kid? The cooler dad, though. You know, the dad who wasn't a dad, you know?
You'd think so.
You'd think so. But then when you grow up and become a dad, you're like, that guy didn't teach me anything about being a dad. He just taught me the fun parts of being a dad, but not the serious important parts of...
So if you don't shave your balls, do they say, oh, sorry, we can't do the surgery? Or do they get a nurse
Well,
to do
no,
it?
They shave them for you, apparently.
I think they might, but at the same time, they said we want it done ahead of time. So I think that, you know, NHS cutbacks, they're trying to save time with ball shaving.
Yeah.
Add up a whole year worth of ball shaving, you could treat another 10 patients in that time.
Probably, yeah.
So I mean, get them to shave it at home.
That's what it comes down to. Any extra stuff that the NHS has to do is just money down the toilet, isn't it?
So it's just before you go in for a big operation, you know, just get ready, get the robes ready, put them on at home, you know, get yourself injected with the anesthetic, do that at home. You know, they said you like a pre-measured syringe for you to like get yourself all numbed up before you get there.
Yeah, I feel like I would get some of that. If I was going to shave my balls, I would get some of the gel with like the minty, like numbing factor for my balls.
You wouldn't
balls.
Want the mint on there, would you?
I would, yeah.
Let's make it like a camping trip. You know, you bring your own camp bed, you bring your own packed lunch, right? And so they don't have to feed you or like, you know, get a bed or anything. You can just turn up, pitch your tent, set up the camp bed.
Hey, that's dangerous.
And then like tie a little thing around your wrist that like is like a tag and it says, you know, left kidney removed, please. Shave your balls and everything.
Yeah.
Draw with like a Sharpie, a big X on your left kidney where you think that is. You know, there'll be like a diagram. It's like IKEA, right?
Do you think he drew an X on his balls with Sharpie?
Well,
these is balls.
Well, it depends how many balls he needs to have vasectomied. You know, you just shoot.
Well,
you've
got to have them all done. So here's the other thing. Once you've had it done, you then have to wait, I think it was 2 or 3 weeks before using it, shall we say.
Using the balls.
And you have to run the pipes through, as the surgeon put it, 25 times in like a 30-day period. 25 times and
run
then
run the pipes through.
Run the pipes. You
oh,
know what
I
I'm saying?
And he has to run the...
to check it's clear, to get rid of every little guy.
Right, okay.
I'm just thinking of Mario right now.
Yeah, every little guy that could be lurking in there. Run them all through and then they test your sperm and they're like, "Yeah, it's dead now. It's just a you know, goop."
It's just the delivery mechanism
it
left.
It is. There's no little ads left.
You have to do 30, you have to make 30 deposits. In the pipes, the pipes.
No. That's how many you run it through, and then you make a deposit eventually. Because there's no point testing it early on. Apparently, there's still some lurkers.
Yeah, there's still
some campers, to put it in gaming terms.
Yeah.
Oh, nice camping, dude. That's what the tester would say.
Right.
A little tiny sperm pops out. Because I guess all it'd take is one, right? One dude. And imagine if you only had one lad that escaped, and he was like, just happened to make it there to the egg.
I think
he could
deserves
be the worst
it.
Sperm. No, he could be the worst one.
I think
one.
He deserves it if he's made it all through. It's really
it's
tough.
It's like one of the 100 meters with just some dude they found in the stadium.
Yeah, it's like your Cletus sperm. He's still like lurking around, like, you know, threatening.
He never would have made it.
No, it's more like the Forrest Gump sperm who's like made it across America despite all odds.
That's
you know?
Right. Yeah, against all the odds, and he's there and he's ready.
He deserves it.
So you got to make sure that he's gone because you don't want to have your own gum.
Give it to him. Go on, give him a chance. Give him a little chance. Go for
anyway,
it.
Anyway, the pigeon in my tree, right? So he moves to another tree, and then they were the pair of them.
Right.
And I have a bird feeder in my garden. I think we mentioned this before. I feed the birds. It's very, you know, it's soothing.
It's very pleasant.
It's very nice.
It's very middle class. It's very English, yeah.
But I found one of the dead wood pigeons. It was dead.
No!
Yeah, in my garden. Obviously attacked by something. Not my cat. It was It was like a fox or something had got it. Because it was like shredded.
Oh, chainsaw injury.
Jeez.
Yeah, I was like, oh shit. I mean, because we get foxes around here during the day. The other day, I went out, it was like 1 o'clock in the afternoon. I went downstairs to make a cup of tea, and there lying on my back flower bed is a fox, big old fox. And he saw me, he was like, oh shit, and sort of ran out of the garden.
Shit.
I was like, damn, it's like middle of the day, these motherfuckers.
They're dangerous as fuck too. They kill babies and everything.
Oh, I think that's a myth. But
a dingo ate my baby.
Exactly.
Turned out that was actually a thing that did happen though.
Yeah, I think, well, they think it happened anyway, but yeah. Yeah. I mean, the thing is, like, foxes are, I don't think they're really dangerous. I mean, one bit Mrs. F, but she was okay.
Yeah, no, they don't sound dangerous at all.
I just bit her on the leg.
Jeez.
It was she was on her way into work. It's like, you know, 8 o'clock in the morning.
She's on the tube.
He gets on. She thinks nothing of it. He's, you know, anyway. So he walks towards her and she's like, oh, he'll run away when he sees me. He obviously hasn't seen me. He runs up and she's thinking, damn, this fox is really close. And he just goes, arr, and bites her on the back of the leg.
Christ.
She was in tears.
I
she came out. Whoa, whoa, God, whoa. And I was like, what the fuck happened? He goes, I got bitten by
a fox. You have to get rabies shots and stuff?
No. There's no rabies in England. But
she's got rabies now.
She has now.
She just foams at the mouth for no reason. She occasionally devours a pigeon.
Yeah, but you know, that's what happened to the pigeon. Obviously, it misses her. Feathers all over her mouth. But so she had to go to the doctors and they said, we don't even need to give you a shot for this. It's no big deal. And she was fine. But
stop making a big fucking... Look, if you want to come to the doctors, you're going to have to shave your balls. You're going to have to bring a packed lunch in a tent. You know, the whole thing. Okay? We don't see your stuff anymore.
Listen, I'm here. I'm getting a shot. I don't even care what it is. Just shoot me with something because I've been bitten by a fox. And shave my balls while you're
if
at
I'm
it.
If I'm coming all the way out there, just give me an injection of anything. What you got? Go on. Give me something. Measles, mumps, rubella? Is that still going on? I'll have one of them.
Sure, yeah.
So I'm not making it a wasted trip.
Just give me a fucking injection of something.
I mean, I'm here, so I might as well have the fucking flu one. Give me the meningitis one. You know, just give them all of them.
Fuck.
Might as well. I'm here. Malaria. Do me.
But so Mr. or Mrs. Pidgey, whichever is the one that's left, is still hanging around in the garden. And it's kind of sad. He's just here. You know, because this is still where he lives. And I think this fucking pigeon's been through the ringer in terms of what a wood pigeon could...
Yeah.
His partner was murdered by a fox. His home was destroyed by so-called tree surgeons. And, you know, and now these fucking squirrels have moved in. So anytime I put birdseed out, these two motherfuckers jump off the fence onto the bird table, eat the whole lot in like 2 seconds and fuck off. So I have to keep topping it up to try and hope the birds can fucking get some.
Hang on a second.
So this pigeon's like, this is the worst.
Well, yeah,
so,
but pigeons are resourceful though. Like if some of the seed drops into the grass or whatever, they'll just peck the ground and
but that's
get
the problem
is
I'm worried they go down there. I've got a cat. Now she's old and slow and she just kind of watches the birds and goes, meh, you know,
so
meh.
What other animals are eating the bird seed stuff off?
Other birds.
Right.
Squirrels.
Yeah,
and that's cats. Pretty much it.
Well, it's not a bird feeder, is it? If it's a fucking feeding the squirrels, you've got a squirrel.
But it
feeder
is a bird
there.
Feeder. No, it's just it's on a big thing. They just climb up.
You got the wrong thing, mate. You need a bird feeder there. You got a squirrel feeder.
I've got one of those hanging bird feeders that the birds have to peck at.
Yeah,
right. But that's only good for the little birds. The pidgey, he can't eat that.
We got one of those big tube ones that you put those big balls in, like for the winter.
Yeah.
But man, birds do not like.
They
those.
Love the fat balls. Are you kidding me?
Oh, Blue they didn't eat our balls.
Love those. Oh
no.
Man, my balls have been shaven and
our
eaten
balls
by
just
these
like
birds.
Were rotten and crumbling and going
oh,
all
geez.
Shitty. Like they didn't bother with them at
are
all.
Are they like the resiny, waxy ones? The what they?
It's like
of?
A ball of lard with seeds in it, basically.
Yeah, like a hardened
it's pretty
ball of. Lard, yeah.
Is the reason that squirrels don't like eating lard? Or, I mean, can you like lard lube up the area around the squirrel, the bird feeder with lard so the squirrels will slip off? I saw that was a thing you could do at some point.
No, I think what you generally do with squirrels is
do you leave out like a half filled glass of beer? And then they all fall in and drown.
I was gonna shoot them with my air rifle. But
I think you can shoot them, and I think if you put like a plate at the bottom of the feeder, and then you hang it like on a wire or something like that, they can't get to it.
But they Although can they... jump from my fence.
Oh.
I see them do it. Like it's a 6-foot fence. They climb up the fence and they leap, land on the bird feeder, and then eat, and then leap off again. Like there's
put,
no
like,
way around
some
it.
Some mini electric fence around.
I was just going to shoot them. I think it's the easiest option. And it's legal.
No, I think like Jurassic Park solution is going to be the one. Like just, you know, plug
into the
mains.
What could go wrong?
Yeah.
Nothing could go wrong. I could have a little squirrel enclosure. Uh-huh. And they could, when they get out, one will sneak up on me. I'll be like, clever girl.
That's right.
Squirrels right there.
And then you could ride on that little trike and train them.
Squirrels are like a big problem when you're trying to feed birds for sure.
Oh, and they're fucking so tenacious. They shout at you. They go up in the tree. They're like,
they
make these horrible noises.
Yeah.
Ghastly creatures.
I like squirrels. You know, they're cute.
What's wrong with you?
They love nuts.
Oh, they're aggressive too. Did you ever see that video of the squirrel attacking somebody? Like not full on attacking, but chasing after them. Like, oh, they are so untrustworthy, squirrels.
Wait, what? Why does Lewis like them?
Well, they're like part of the nature of furniture of life around you and niceness. It's nice to see.
So are mosquitoes.
Lewis has never seen one before.
To be walking along through a tranquil glade and a little squirrel whoop, 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 comes along like, oh, just appears in front of you, looks around, goes back up a tree. It's cute. It's nice. It's nice to see.
Attacks you, steals your lunch.
They're not. They're twitchy. Their eyes are like wide open. They look sketchy as fuck all the time. Like... They're not
that dirty and manky.
They got really sharp teeth.
Some of the manky seagulls and pigeons. Really.
Seagulls are majestic. They spend all the. They've got those beautiful big wings, that big head.
Yeah.
They go out there in the weather. You know what I mean? They're flying out over the ocean. They're eating fish. I've got nothing but admiration for the seagull.
They're like garbage gulls, though. They're like
gulls. They really
the ones
do
you have in Bristol are bad, but I think there's nothing more majestic than a great big fucking
so
sea
obnoxious
bird.
Obnoxious as well, sounding like.
Yeah, the ones in Jersey are really bad too.
You know, how annoying are squirrels?
I like it. It makes me, growing up by the sea, I crave that sound.
How do you feel about cicadas? You know, that noise. Oh,
yeah, they're amazing. Have you ever seen one?
Yeah, but I
oh my
I mean,
god, they're so fucking big. Those things are so fucking big.
And they're so loud. Holy shit.
Yeah.
Like when you
I mean, my dad lives in Florida. He, you know, when it's cicada season, they're so fucking loud. Like, they're just everywhere. But it becomes like part of the background noise. I feel like I'm in the movie Predator when I hear the cicada.
Do you think that white noise is like a good thing or a bad thing? Like, because some people really hate it, but some people like really like can't sleep without it, right? Some people have to play rain sounds on Alexa or whatever to actually sleep and stuff.
I don't do the rain sounds. I mean, no. I like total silence and total darkness to sleep. I used to be able to sleep pretty much anywhere, anytime, no matter what was going on.
Yeah, I'm
but
like
since
that
I
now.
Had kids, I've lost that. I've lost that ability.
Oh,
because,
I've gained that through having
no, I'm
kids.
Always
Man,
listening
I fall
out.
Asleep on command now. Like it's,
I'm always
I'm like
listening out,
zoning
dude.
Out and falling asleep all the time.
Do you have to have the crying of a plaintive child in order to sleep?
Yeah, it's like if I hear a child, that's it. I can't nap. If there's some kid, the kid next door goes, wah! I'm like, well, that's it.
I'm off.
Yeah, I'm awake.
Oh, you're awake. No, I thought it would be the other way around. Now you just you'd learn to sleep through anything.
And no, because yeah, I'm looking after them all day. So you know when they were babies or whatever, you know I'm listening out for them all the time. I'm sort of not on edge, but I'm like on sentry duty. Right. You know I'm on alert.
Yeah.
Any the snap of a twig or some whispered German commands, Angriffen, for you know somewhere. I'm like they're here, lads. You know, so it's like I'm on sentry duty.
My daughter's going through this like weird period of emotional development. Now and she just cries all the time for like and not it's not like tantrum crying, it's just like sort of like whimpering like and anything.
I reckon that's second child syndrome, dude, because my
she'll kick
too.
A rock on the road accidentally while walking. I'll be like, oh look, you kicked a rock. I should just start crying. Like it's only a rock, you don't have to cry. So now like it's almost like the boy who cried wolf now, like because she's been crying so much recently. It doesn't affect either of us now.
Dude, I honestly think it's a second kid thing because my youngest was the exact same
I know
same
grown
shit.
Women who cry that much.
Yeah.
They're just emotional sips. Just women are emotional creatures.
You fucking idiot.
Man.
They just get... No, I think sometimes kids don't necessarily understand the world, do they? Like, they think that if they kick that rock and it goes around the corner, that rock has disappeared from the universe forever. And
no, they're not babies. They have object permanence, you idiot.
Okay,
they get that in, like, a few months.
It just feels like every time you speak to them, they just cry. Like, it's right. Like, overwhelming to be spoken to
that
somehow.
That happens with me and women, too, though, to be fair.
Yeah, me too, yeah.
Now you're being accurate. See, yeah. That's accurate.
Yeah, women are terrified of me. They'll never admit it, but...
And I'm terrified of them. I don't understand them. That's why they're so scary.
Oh, my God.
Holy fucking shit. So, no, squirrels, man. I don't know. I feel like they don't deserve such hatred.
I feel like they could go into room 101 easy. Like, fucking nobody likes squirrels. They're stupid. They're stupid and
some
useless.
Some twat in the comments will like squirrels. I love squirrels. Shut up.
Yeah.
Shut up.
Well, that guy can... You know what? If that guy loves him so much, why doesn't he open up his house and all the squirrels can go live there with him? And then he'd be doing the rest of the human race a favor because nobody else likes squirrels.
True.
It could be like Ace Ventura, but only squirrels.
Good call.
Yeah.
What was that movie with Brendan Fraser where he got attacked by beavers or squirrels or whatever?
Blast from the Past.
Are you sure?
No. It's the only Brendan Fraser movie I can think of off the top of my head.
So
The Mummy.
So I
it was
watched
The Mummy.
The new dinosaur movie with
the new new Jurassic movie. What's it called?
Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom.
Fallen Kingdom.
Fallen Empire.
Right.
Fallen World.
Right.
Fallen something.
Fallen World. I've only seen the original Jurassic Park. I've never seen any of the other movies.
Well, Jurassic World came out a couple of years back. It was okay, it was kind of a little bit like what Force Awakens was to Star Wars. Do you know what I mean? The Force Awakens was kind of a retelling of the same story in a modern with a new cast of characters kind of thing,
right?
You know, so Jurassic World is kind of the same. It's like a retelling of Jurassic Park, only it happens again kind of thing, right? It feels like it's this series of very safe choices made, which are these big action sequences that are a lot of fun, but actually the movie doesn't have like very much substance in terms of a story, but it's fun. Like, you know, I just, like sometimes in a movie, okay, I don't know if you guys get this, you're like, you need to pee, but it's too exciting for you to leave, right? And you think, oh, I don't really want to leave. In this movie, I was like, meh, I'll go and have a pee.
Yeah.
And so I got up, I went out of pee, came back, literally wasn't, you know, it wasn't a big deal. Whereas I feel like some movies, if you do that, you're like, oh God, what have I missed in the fucking 10 minutes, 10 seconds that I've had to leave?
Yeah.
10 minutes.
I had to go pee for about, like about an hour into The Quiet Place. And then I just refused to go because I didn't want to miss anything because I was like fucking super invested.
That's a great
But yeah, movie. I know what you mean. Some movies you're just like, nah, I probably won't. Like I took my son to a birthday party and they went to see Ferdinand, the animated movie.
Mm-hmm.
I peed like three times during that movie. It was fine. I didn't miss much.
You'd rather not endure the discomfort.
Yeah, no, it was an all right movie.
In fact, you're like looking for an excuse. It's like it's like that time you don't even really need to pee. You're just going in there and, you know, going through the motions. You're like, well.
Yeah. I was like checking my phone every sort of 20 minutes to see what time it was and
just
stuff.
Examining
and
your balls, saying maybe it's getting a bit bushy down here. Yeah,
just thinking about like how I'd go about shaving my balls and thinking of some DIY tasks around the house and how I was going to tackle them like later on in the weekend and stuff. And
I went to see Solo last night.
Oh, was that good?
I really enjoyed it. Yeah,
I gotta go see that. Still.
It was fun. It was a really good looking movie. Like they went for a side of the Star Wars universe you don't get to see that often, which is the kind of filthy, greasy side of Star Wars. You know what I mean? So it was like the places that Han was going. Well, like places that we'd maybe heard mentioned and you know, they'd sort of referenced obliquely, but not actually directly sort of needed to show.
Does he do the Kessel Run in...
He does the Kessel Run in less than 12 parsecs. But here's the interesting thing. I was like, a parsec isn't like a measure of speed. It's a measure of distance. And I obviously thought, how can we do this? So the Kessel Run is more like a maze. And there are routes through it that are sort of less hazardous. And that one, the main route would be 20 parsecs. But obviously... We all know Han Solo finds a route in under 12 parsecs.
Yeah.
And the reason that they come up with that and everything, it was good. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a gorgeous movie. The sets and the props and everything else was perfect, really Star Wars-y, but you didn't feel like you were just watching any old Star Wars movie.
How would you rate it against like Rogue One and like the other new movies? Like,
well,
do you
know
think
what,
it's the worst of all the new movies? Or
no,
do you think
absolutely
it's
not.
Somewhere
no,
in the middle? Or
I mean, I really loved The Force Awakens. I thought it was fantastic.
Yeah.
Even though, like Lewis said, it was, you know, kind of a rehashing. It was very similar to the original New Hope.
Which isn't a bad thing.
No, it's not a bad thing because remember that we grew up with that movie, or a lot of us did.
Yeah.
But a whole new audience did not.
It feels like the Force Awakens had the advantage of there not having been a Star Wars movie for such a long time, though. So they
not
could
a good
kinda,
one especially, but
they
yeah.
could kind of get away with, you know, a bit of rehashing.
It feels like people are actually fairly forgiving of reboots, though. I mean, Spider-Man shows you how many times you can reboot stuff. Like,
right, but Homecoming was actually good because they did it the right way.
We've been
like, they didn't
this,
just they didn't just reboot the same shit. Like, I don't need to see him get bit. Like,
I
you
don't
said,
believe
Bitten
you. I don't need to see another Spider-Man movie.
Right.
I'm done.
But Homecoming was genuinely good because I like what they've done with the extended universe. All right, let me. You're not letting me, sir.
I know, but it's like,
sir,
I'm gonna do what you do about
sir.
Anime and Harry Potter. All right, I'm just gonna be like, no,
I
not watching
Harry
it.
Potter.
Not, you're
I've
not
watched
gonna
Harry
convince
Potter
me to
and
see
I've
the
anime.
New Spider-Man movie. I'm not done. I'm not gonna listen.
You don't have to. I'm talking to the audience at home. You're done. All right. Here's the point. Is that what they've done with the extended universe is that you'll see these other characters dip in and out and I remember that bit from so-and-so movie and I like that because that's like the comics, like
it
I said
like
before.
It is like fan-service-y as well,
of
right?
course. It's, I mean, what the fuck is a movie? Is a movie meant to be for an audience that isn't going to go and watch it? Like when people say, oh, it's just fan service. That's just service for the people who paid to see the movie and like the series.
All right.
Jesus. Make it for people that didn't want to see the movie and would never have seen it in a million years. That's the people you should be looking at. I was like, no, fuck those guys. Like, you don't make anime for me. You make it for weebs like you.
All right.
Yeah,
right?
Lewis.
Jeez.
So you big dork.
The reason I was like a little bit turned off of Solo, I haven't seen it yet, but partly is because I guess like this main character reminds me of like Steve Holt, right?
Went to /r/Star Wars and you saw a million people all together condemning a movie before it even come out or they'd seen it. That's what you did, isn't it?
Did you say he looks like Steve Holt, as in Steve Holt from Arrested Development?
Yeah.
Steve Holt!
He's got that kind of like Captain Kirk-y smug fucking look on all the pictures and stuff. And I don't know who he is necessarily, that actor. I guess, is he an unknown?
No, he was in something. Mrs. F told me about it. What the fuck was it? I'll tell you. Hold on. Give me a chance.
It reminds me of the new Kirk. That's all from the Star Trek films, and I'm like, oh.
Did you see Hail Caesar?
I don't think so.
That's a Coen Brothers movie.
Oh, really?
No, I haven't seen that.
It's very funny. So it's set in the sort of golden age of Hollywood when, you know, the studios owned the actors, and it was all very sort of scummy and all the rest of it. Unlike now, of course.
it's come a long way, hasn't it, though?
So he plays this cowboy actor who they try to shoehorn into a different kind of movie. And he's very, very funny. Like, he's very funny in it. He was in that. I haven't really seen him in much else. I think they, with these movies, they tended to go for actors that you probably don't know because, I mean, people didn't really know Mark Hamill before Star Wars. And I think they were just kind of...
Yeah, I mean, if it was like Matt Damon, I would have just been like, oh, for fuck's sake.
Yeah, you know what you're getting. It's Matt fucking Damon. So they get another guy and he can be anything you want him to be. And he's going to make the character his own rather than Matt Damon coming in and fucking Matt Damoning it up.
It's tricky. I guess they have to find someone who's proven but not like necessarily like, you know, known already.
Right.
Yeah. Proven but not known. Mm.
Exactly.
Proven but not known. Like that guy who plays Doctor Strange. He was like a bit like that, right? He was
Benedict Cumberbatch.
Yeah. Proven but not known. And now he's in everything. Now he's just in everything.
I think everyone was like that at some point, Sips. But I mean,
no, I think especially Benedict Cumberbatch though. He's like the epitome.
Benedict, what is it? Can you spell it? Let me Google this guy. I don't know who.
I'm not sure I know who you mean.
Benedict.
Right.
Cumber snatch.
Cumber bunge. Okay. Cumber snatch. But yeah, do you know what? Actually, talking about movies and things like that, this is interesting. A friend of mine works in TV.
Right.
And
how does she fit in there?
That's fucking stupid.
That's such a dad joke, by the way.
I'm sorry.
That is such a dad. Such you're welcome here now, Lewis. You have proven yourself, young Padawan.
You're Benedict Cumberbatch. Look, you've proven yourself now. You can be on every show forever now.
You are in. That is the most dad fucking joke.
The delivery was so dead. You out-dadded two dads. Me and Flax could never have done that.
That was perfect. Because most dads tell that joke with a sort of,
oh my God.
How does he fit in there? You were just like, boom. Dad joke. Have you got like a dad joke a day calendar or something? And that was today's.
Oh, I need to get one.
Damn.
Oh my God.
So anyway.
That's too much.
My friend was saying that all the people that you know, okay, in movies, all these stars and all these directors, all these people that you think like, man, they seem like a really nice guy. Asshole. Like all of them. Because I was saying like, what about so-and-so? Not so-and-so. Oh yeah, complete asshole. Oh, the stories I've got about them. And then tell me all these awful things that these people have done and how they talk to people, how they are on set and all the rest of it. Horrible. Horrible. And I was like, oh my God. Like this, so this one guy, he's a director. Directed a movie, had his editor editing the movie for a whole year, and then the editor was sat in the premiere, and the movie that was on screen was not the movie that he'd cut. He was like, this isn't my film, I didn't cut this. And what had happened is the director had secretly had a second editor also editing for a full year, and then decided which cut he liked best. That's psychopathic.
Yeah,
that means he wasted a year of his life and put his heart and soul into editing this movie, because they really do fucking care. Like, every shot, the editors pour over it. It's so fucking intense.
That is a real lesson in being passive aggressive, isn't it?
Yeah, like, but fucking, why not just say? Shit. Why not just say, I'd like you guys to work on this together or something? Because like, he just thought, I will pit them against one another, like some kind of Machiavellian plot, some Game of Thrones shit. Just chill out, dude. But yeah, so that was kind of a dick move. But that's just like one of the minor things. It's just,
I don't know.
Insane.
I don't know. Like, for me, that actually makes perverted sense. Like,
that's because you're a sick man.
But you are pretty twisted, Lewis. It's
got
to
be said. Like, imagine you've got, like, imagine it's the smallest thing, though. Imagine it's like a script, okay, for like a concept, for like a 15-minute animation or something, you know. You know, you want to pitch it to people. And, you know, if you're willing to pay people for a couple of weeks' work to write a script and then you don't use it, they've still gotten paid for that.
Sure, but I think you're up front with people. I don't think you leave them in the dark. I think you, at the start you say, listen, you're writing a script and I've got two other people writing scripts as well. And at the end, we're going to pick the one that we like the best. So just so you know, at the end of this, we might not use your script, but we'll still pay you for it.
I don't know if that's even worse, though, Sips, because at least then you're putting the pressure on someone.
I think just a bit of communication. But then they have the chance to opt out. They could say, you know what? I'm not comfortable with this. I don't want to do it. And then you can find someone else who's okay with it. But I think
that sounds even more psychopathic, though, than to me.
No, that doesn't. I think that's just
being...
Because
at least if they're just like lazily going through in their own time, editing it to the standard they're happy with, you know, they're not feeling like this is competition and there's like pressure, you know, you'll end up with weird people editing it if you make it into a competition. You know, you have to keep it natural. I kind of think.
Right. So you think that not telling them that it's a competition and then potentially wasting all of their time.
But also if their one is worse, then they don't get to, you know, it's like, well, sorry, you know, yours was just, we didn't go with yours. You still get paid. You know, you're still a job, isn't it? Like anyone's job. Like,
so if you're ever wondering what it's like to work at Yogg's Tower, this should be a real insight.
Imagine, like, I don't know, any other job, though. Imagine if you worked in like, Starbucks, you know, and you made a coffee for someone and you had another barista there making coffee and you know, after a whole year, you found out that, you know, all the coffees you'd been making were being, like, poured down the drain. You know, how does that make you feel? Like, I don't know. Like.
I think if somebody told me ahead of time that that might happen, then at least I'd be ready for it.
Right.
But if I found out at the end that it was just like some sort of weird subset of the movie The Game, where people were pouring out all the coffees in disgust and then going back to another person and getting better coffees poured for them, I'd be pretty hacked off.
I also feel like
what the fuck?
I don't know how much can you learn if you're working on like a movie for a whole year and then I'm moving over from to your side now here, by the way, but I feel like how do you get the feedback from that? You know, if you watched a movie that they did and you think, oh he did it like this, like, surely there'd be loads of things that you did better in your movie, but then you wouldn't know that they were the things you did better, because Maybe if he gave like a really detailed feedback at the end and he was like, hey, yeah, I preferred your thing here, his thing here, your thing here. You know, surely you could integrate both together into a sort of, some sort of final cut where the two of you come
together.
Yeah, maybe,
but it's up to the guy who's like commissioning it all and directing it, right? Like if he wants to do it, or maybe he just thinks one cut's like overall just better. And then
maybe you get a third editor. Okay, afterwards. And he cuts together the best bits from both the cuts.
Yeah, maybe.
Would that be okay?
I don't know. I think, like, it's weird when you make, like, you know, if you're editing a movie from start to finish and it takes you a year, right? And then you send your cut through and somebody says, you know what, parts of this are good, but we're not going to use it. We're going to use Jimmy's instead because
this
is way better.
This bit doesn't have enough dinosaurs, you know?
Yeah. I think you got to sort of be ready for that sort of stuff in that capacity to begin with, because you're never going to do something perfect, no matter how much you think it's going to be perfect or it is perfect, because you're always at the mercy.
My children are perfect.
Yeah, aww. But you're always at the mercy of somebody else's
don't
take or opinion or whatever.
Yeah.
Right?
I think your children
but
suck.
The way that you have to look at all of this stuff is that it's just experience and you're learning and you're doing new stuff and eventually one day something you do and it's going to be the least expected thing probably that you thought, you know, oh, I've done this, but like, it's not going to go anywhere. And then that turns out to be like the big breakout thing that everyone's like, oh, fuck, this is incredible sort of thing. And you didn't expect it. I think if you have that sort of mindset, you set yourself up a lot better to not be devastated every time something doesn't go your way. Because I think a lot of people do that, right? They put their heart and soul into something and they expect that it's just going to go somewhere and be something. But life doesn't really work like that at all, does it? Like you have to sort of take everything as an experience, learn from it, just do better next time. And then usually when you least expect it, something pays off.
I was on the bus yesterday, right? And the bus broke down.
There was a fox on the bus.
There were no squirrels, no foxes.
And they sent you to the hospital. They gave you a fucking... You were like, give me an injection. They gave you a free injection.
They shaved your balls and they put you back on a bus that was working. And then...
The bus broke down. Okay.
And then that one broke down.
I'm on the bus. It's packed. All these school kids, little kids, all the rest of it. And the bus breaks down.
Annoying.
And this old guy, I say old, he must have been in his 50s. Seems old to me even now.
Old.
Old.
Bald.
He goes,
grumpy looking.
What the fuck is going on? Like, really loudly.
Was this you?
Right.
No, it wasn't me. I was thinking that, but I was just in kind of a chill mood, so I was just chilling.
You'd had that injection earlier.
I'm with my daughter, so, you know, she looks at me, and I look at her, and we're sort of like, eyes wide, and be like, oh, he said a bad word. And then everybody's kind of looking at this guy thinking, you know, calm down, mate, we're all stuck on the bus. And luckily it had broken down, like, at my stop, so I didn't really care, I was just waiting for him to open the door, or just to stop before. So then... The bus driver tries to restart the bus, and I hear it. There's like a computer that says oil levels low or temperature too high. Like the bus fucking talks to him, which I thought was pretty cool. And then he opens a little guard door that they're behind.
Hello, Dave.
Start the bus, Hal.
I'm
afraid I can't do that, Dave.
Don't leave me.
I can't start the bus, Dave. Open the bus bay doors, Hal. I can't do that, Dave.
There's a fox outside. I don't want to let the fox in.
He steps out and he says, the bus is broken down, it's too hot, we can't go anywhere. And the guy goes, I paid £50 a month for this, and the last bus broke down and was cancelled, and now this one is broken down, what are you going to do about it? And the driver just sort of got back in the seat and just sat there waiting for the bus to cool down. And then he thought better of it and got off and sort of walked around the bus, made it look like he was,
looking,
you know, trying
bus.
To fix it or something. And I was just like, I just got off. But this old guy was still going on, and I'm thinking... For that old fella, that's like a major... He wasn't even old. I don't know why I keep calling him old. I don't know why I keep thinking, this guy is furious.
It's because that's the kind of thing like an old fella would do.
But you must have something better to
what
do.
What a fucking journey, though. Imagine that's your life, getting angry at the dumbest shit imaginable. Like,
isn't that what
just,
we do
just
on
sit
this
on the fucking bus and shut up. It'll be fixed in a second. Like, it's not that big of a deal, is it? Jeez.
I had to break up a fight on a bus one time. This is a few years ago, between the driver and a passenger. Okay.
Okay.
So the bus stops way past the stop.
Well, like, how far are we talking here?
Oh, a long way past. Like, the bus driver was obviously
like meters?
Oh, no, like...
A mile.
30, 40 meters, I'd say. Like,
right,
okay. Like, it doesn't just... here's what happens. You know those bus drivers that drive like a fucking cowboy or like some kind of rally driving, and you realize, okay, this is his last trip, and then he drops the bus off and he's done for the day. So he's just like, fucking, let's go, foot down. So he's flying around this corner. He goes shooting past the stop, and there's this woman waving like crazy, like she's trying to flag down a rescue ship or something. And he sort of spots her, and he thinks, fuck it. And then he also thinks, oh, I can't, because the bus has got people on, and they might report me. So he hammers on the brakes. We all go flying forward, and he stops. Woman gets on the bus, and she's fucking giving him all this shit, calling him all these names,
wow.
Swearing at him. And he's giving her shit back, and he's like, fuck you, and all this kind of stuff. And then... She says, just get going. I want to go home. He goes, I'm not moving this bus. And he crosses his arms and he like turns the bus off and he's just sitting there.
Oh, my God.
And everyone sat there in complete silence, right?
What a guy.
I hate bus drivers. I hate them.
Okay, good. I like where this is going.
So I thought, fuck this. So I'm right at the back of the bus. So I'm looking around and everybody's just sort of looking down at the ground. So I get up and I walk to the front of the bus and I say, look, I get it. We all have shit days. You want to go home? You want to go home? We all want to go home. Just start the fucking bus and let's go home. And they both sort of went and did it. Like,
oh
she
God.
Just went and sat down and he just turned on the bus. And I thought any moment the bus is going to break out and applause. Yeah, woo!
No.
Not a thing.
People are too scared.
You're like the diplomatic dad.
I was furious. Not a word. Not a word said by anybody. We just silently went home. It was so stupid.
That's
can I just,
hilarious.
One
but a
can
few
I just
months later...
Pop to the loo? I really need to go to the loo.
Do you need to pop to the loo?
Yeah, just one second.
All right. He's gone.
It's just like when he walks out of movies. This is it. He's going to miss the best
that,
bit.
That's a really good sort of summary of the podcast. It's so good that he's decided to go to the toilet. Halfway through it.
Do you reckon he's shaving his balls in there?
He might be trying to shave. Yeah, there's been a lot of hints on like good ways to shave your balls, so maybe he's just couldn't wait to try them out. He's just got to try to shave his
balls.
He's
just going to go shave those balls real quick.
I've never had a bad bus experience. Like,
really?
I think the worst bus experience I've had, and it's not even that bad, was it was in Canada. It was really cold. It was like minus 15 out, and it was snowing and stuff. And the heaters on the bus weren't working as well as they could, so the bus was kind of cold. So it was like a little bit uncomfortable to sleep on the bus for the hour and a half that I was on the bus for.
Man.
But I still managed to fall asleep anyway, and then it was fine. Like, that's it. That's the worst one I've got. Yeah.
Wow.
I've never had to like yell at anyone or do anything. Oh, one time this guy was standing, you know, when the bus is like super busy.
Right.
This guy was standing really close to me, and he had track pants on, and the smell that was coming off of his track pants was like nothing I've ever smelled before.
Oh my God. You know, when you smell a really stinky person, it is such a, like, it's the worst odor.
But this was, that smell kind of soaked in and stuck inside thick track pants. So you had that fabric smell plus like the body smell. Well, it was really gross, and it kept wafting. He was standing right in front of me, so it was wafting into my face constantly.
Oh my God.
I would think that was worse than the cold bus, but even then, those two are the ones that I can think of. Where,
you know, when I was at TI a few years ago, it was real hot, okay? And there was this one guy walking around the whole time, and I don't think he had ever washed, like, ever. And he was like one of the...
What, so that he could play Dota?
No, I just think he was just disgusting.
Oh, right.
He was just one of those disgusting people that just sees it as optional.
Yeah.
And like, oh, no, I don't see why I should wash. I smell doesn't bother me. So there's a line of people queuing up to get autographs from the players and stuff. And there's like, there's the line, and then there's about a 10-foot break, and then there's this guy, and then there's a 10-foot break, and then there's the rest of the line. So he's just basically queuing on his own. He still moves up. Like, the guy in front of him moves up, he moves up, but he doesn't move up till he's next to that guy. He obviously realizes.
Oh, he's doing it on purpose then. He's got to be. He wants more space. He wants more personal space.
It might be some weird thing that he's going like, if I smell real bad, people won't bother me. So it might be something like that.
I think that's it. I think that's what he's doing. It's kind of clever when you think of it, because, you know, if you don't want people to approach you ever or stand right up in your space, don't wash, and people won't.
And then go post on fucking r/incels about it.
Yeah, true.
But I've been alone for my whole life, and all right, I have a body odor problem. By choice. I'm involuntarily celibate, but I'm voluntarily stinky. The vole stink community.
Oh my God. It's like nature. It's
in smell.
And animals
in
do
smell.
That. It's like a human skunk. He's got defense systems set up around his poor hygiene, which means that nobody will ever go within 10 feet of him. So
do you reckon, like, you know the way big fish in the ocean have like those little fish to follow them around? I'm figuring that if you're that unhygienic, you probably have some kind of insect life dwelling in the creases of your
body. Oh, you do
body.
For sure, yeah. You'll have, like, bacteria eating away all
you're
of
like
your
a,
gross
you're
BO
an ecosystem.
Stuff,
yeah, you're an ecosystem.
Sorry, I had to pee. I was like,
I know,
oh.
It's
yeah,
fine.
Yeah,
it's
we
fine.
Know, we know. Welcome back. We held down the fort while you were gone. Don't worry about
it. It was like being at a cinema. The content was just not entertaining enough.
No,
yeah. I was like, I was busting.
We get it.
I've just been sitting here drinking like this entire fucking pot of tea, and it was just like went straight through me.
Yeah, tea will do that.
Hey, on the topic of angry people, I've been watching Parks and Recreation, the show.
Love that show.
It's really funny. And I was reading a bit about, you know, how they conceived the show and how they were writing for it. And apparently the writing team had to attend local town hall meetings, quite a few of them too, in smaller towns, just to get a feel for the kind of things that come up in, like,
yes,
these town hall meetings.
Right, right.
And what they found consistently was that the only people that ever went to these meetings were very, very angry people who opposed what was being proposed, sort of thing.
Right.
So they would turn up and they would have these outlandish sort of demands and oppositions to what was, you know, being planned. They said that it was just almost like a comedy gold mine. Like, the people were nuts. Like, they would turn up. And it's like on the show, you know, sometimes you get that, like, the woman who's like, all the sandwiches I find on the ground in the park have no mayonnaise on them. Like, you know, yeah, like, just these really stupid things. But they said that a lot of it was influenced by them having to go on site and witness some of these town hall meetings.
I've been eating squirrels around the area, and they're all covered in slippery lard. Please stop putting lard balls on our bird feeders?
I watched the one yesterday with the Sweetums, you know, with the super sweet fructose, and they're trying to get the deal for the park. And the woman's like, I've been eating lasagna and muffins solely for my whole life, and I am very depressed.
So anyway, PFAX, a few months later on the bus, because this is what Trifles Podcast is all about, by the way, is shitty local stories of what
PFAX that's my favorite kind, my absolute favorite kind. So I'm on the bus, and there's this old fella gets on. He's one of these old people you think, geez, someone get this guy a wheelchair. Like, this guy needs to not keep with the walking. He's got two sticks, and he moves it like less than a snail's pace.
That's just fucking greedy. Why does he need two?
he needs it because he can barely stand.
Some of those people they just don't have a family looking after them, clearly.
I honestly think that's it. No one has said to him, for God's sake, Dad, get a fucking chair,
because
this is ridiculous.
This is why you have to have kids, because you turn into that lonely guy with two sticks later in life that nobody's around to help you.
Absolutely. Listen, when they say poor people in poor countries shouldn't have kids, who the fuck's going to look after them, man?
I've said it before, and I'll say it again. You're playing the long game when you have kids. Sure, it sucks when they're young and you have to raise them and stuff, but man, they can look after you when you're old. You're never going to be lonely again.
Yeah, they do say that you have to keep active, right? Because if you're an old person, this is this right now, you have to stay active. That old man, good for him, right? I want him to stay active and energetic, but honestly, him like hunched over, struggling down that street with two walking sticks at like fucking the slowest pace you've ever seen in your life. I mean, I guess he's out there for like 8 hours, but holy shit, like, fucking, I don't know, man. Like, it's just it's madness.
It takes him like a minute just to get on the bus. Like, this dude is basically, this guy's basically disabled. Like, honestly, he can barely get on the bus. He like inches onto the bus, and the fucking bus driver waits for him to get his old guy pass out. And I'm like, fucking come on, dude. The dude's like 118 years old. Just say, go on, sir, don't worry. So the old dude's like, you know, shaky hand. He's going for his pocket. Oh, got my pass in here somewhere.
Well,
gets his pass out, shows his pass. Dude, if you're over 65, you get the free bus pass.
I know. But sometimes I think there's definitely a line there that you have to tread carefully, because if he's out and about and he's still doing things by himself, he just wants to be treated like everybody else, right? So maybe he wants
pass to be checked. The dude is ancient. What, and just in case he's a really old 64, he's had a really hard life.
My dad fucking loves it when he can claim the OAP pass access for a fucking museum or whatever. He's all over that,
man.
He's like, he's every time we go to an art gallery or anything, he's scanning the board, seeing if there's like an OAP 5 quid discount.
My parents are like that too. It's like a badge of honor. Like, okay, great, just put a big sign on your head that says I'm fucking old and I can get into places half price. Great. Like,
but then
just,
again,
so the dude gets on the bus,
right? But this whole thing, it's just a second, it's like being ID'd, okay? Like, you know, I sometimes get ID'd.
Right. So do I. In America, I do all the time.
Therefore, you know, I feel like it could just be that old man was a really rough 60-year-old, you know? He was just had a hard life, you know?
He's just been through it.
Those two sticks.
Oh, God.
You know,
it's all for show.
He'd had his kids. He'd done the vasectomy.
Yeah.
He'd been shed to shave his balls.
he's like decrepit.
I'm a YouTuber. I do full-time YouTube.
Fuck me.
Carry on.
So he gets on the bus.
Oh, my God.
And he's taken like one or two steps down the bus. Driver closes the door, puts the bus in gear, and pulls away. Like, right out into traffic.
Of course he does.
Old dude goes flying, lands on some other old people. They're all trying to hold him up. This old guy's desperately trying to sit down. People are shouting. I shout from the back. Like, when I really shout, I've got quite a loud voice, right? And I shout, would you stop the fucking bus and let that old lad sit down?
Let me guess, the whole bus just went quiet. The bus stopped. All the traffic stops.
I like the idea of you in a fucking school uniform, right? At the back of the bus, like some school bully, basically.
No, this was like a few years ago.
You're surrounded by kids in school uniform.
So this guy, the driver stops the bus, like, opens his door, and he gets out, and he looks down the bus, and he says to me, "I am trying my best." That's what he says. So yeah, I said, "Well, it's not good enough," which is definitely true. I said, "How can you not let this old guy sit down? Look, he can barely stand up." He was like, "I am trying my best. Now, would you leave me alone?" Gets back in the bus. The old guy, we wait for the old guy to sit down. Finally, old guy sits down. Nobody says a word. Like, it's London. So everybody's just thinking, who's this bold lunatic at the back of the bus? But I was right, man. Nobody said shit. Like, how can you just sit there and take that? Like, the bus breaking down, that's not the driver's fault. The driver being a cunt, come on.
You are George Costanza. That's what happens to George Costanza regularly as well when he stands up for people.
I just couldn't believe it. It was just awful. It was so awful. Fucking bus drivers.
I've got an interesting story about bus. So this is the most memorable thing I remember from ParadoxCon. I think, have I told you this? Maybe not. Anyway, we were at ParadoxCon and there was like a shuttle bus that ran from the hotel to the event, because the event this time was actually a little bit further out the city. So we got the bus, shuttle bus back one day, and it was full of peeps. Full of people, and we got back to the hotel, and the hotel was on this big, like, at the crossroads of this big, like, six-way American-style street, okay? So it was, like, huge street, six-way crossing, six streets in each direction, and the hotel's on the corner, and the bus has obviously got this reserved area in front of the hotel where it parks and parks up. So he goes to park up, this bus driver, and there's, a taxi or something just sat in this bay. And the taxi's like being blocked in by another taxi who's being blocked in by another taxi. Anyway, so the bus goes meh, meh, like the biggest, noisiest bus horn you've ever heard, like meh, like this. And then the bus sort of Swedish driver starts yelling, opens the door, starts yelling out the bus door. He doesn't get up from where he is. He just starts yelling out the open double bus doors at this taxi driver who's in the car. And the taxi driver's like, sort of, you know, nods and tries to move and stuff. But the Swedish bus driver's not having any of it. He gives him like 5 seconds and then he just holds down the horn, okay? Now, normally, this is a thing that you see happen, but I kid you not, he just kept holding down the horn for fucking ages. Like, it was, and it didn't fucking stop. It just went on and on and on. And everyone across the road is looking because it's so loud. He's now holding up this disjunction. People behind are like, doing a little bit of hooting, but not anything. They're like, they think like something crazy is happening. They think it's like an air raid siren because it's just so fucking deafeningly loud. Like, people are literally putting their fingers in their ears as they walk by. Like, all the people smoking outside the hotel are like ducking back into the hotel. You're like, and it just goes on and on for like a minute, and then like a minute and a half, then like 2 minutes of just him holding down this horn. And it's fucking nuts. And eventually these taxi drivers move, but you know, even people in the hotel were like, "Fucking, did you like Terps?" Because I think someone was in the hotel at the time and was like, "Fucking, did you hear like what was going on out there? There was just this horn going on for fucking ever." And we were like, "Yeah, that was us. We were on that bus." And so eventually, the fucking taxi driver pulls out and he goes and parks. And then as soon as he like lets his hand off the horn, everyone like fucking visibly like, oh, they relax like around. And he climbs out of the fucking bus and starts yelling at the taxi driver. And I was like, man, how seriously do you take your job for this to be like a thing that you really give a shit about? Like, he was like an old guy as well, like gray hair, kind of like stocky, like glasses, just yelling in Swedish, like at the top of his lungs at this taxi driver. Like,
god damn,
so crazy to see.
You must just hate taxi drivers.
Because it was like the middle of the day. It was like, you know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It wasn't exactly like, you know, it wasn't like a weird time or anything. And it wasn't even that busy really on the streets or anything. It wasn't like it was
I got in a bus stop with a cab driver one time when I beeped him. He got out of the car, which is never a good sign.
No.
So there was like, there's no way past him. And he just stops right in front of these traffic lights. There's no way around him. So I gave him the good old, not a beep, but like a beep, like not bus driver level, but just gave him a good solid 2-3 second beep to let him know he was in the way.
Yeah.
I can see him going mad in the car seat. I immediately think, oh shit, like it's on now. So he opens his door and he comes steaming towards me and I wind down my window like an inch and I'm like, you're in the way. He goes, there is an old lady in there. She is in wheelchair. I have to get her into cab. This is why I stop here. This is why I stop here. You beep me. I was like, dude, calm down. I didn't know. Carry on. And he's like still swearing and cursing. Gets back in his car. But he was so fucking furious. I think, honestly, most people when they drive, they're like a hair away from losing their shit. Like, that's the, they go out with that mentality. They can't just accept some people on the road are fucking idiots. Like, if I'm on the motorway and some guy's tailgating me, you see some people swearing and flipping him off and brake checking him and stuff, just pull over. Let the idiot pass. Don't get involved. Like, genuinely, that's what I'll do.
Well, exactly.
Genuinely.
That's one of the first things I learned when I was driving. It was that I'm not going to be in an accident.
Yeah, he didn't get out and say, I'm going to wait. I'm just waiting for a disabled lad. I was, oh, I'm sorry, no problem. But he was just like, he just went from sitting in a car waiting to losing his fucking marbles in like 2 seconds. So I think you've got to be super careful when you use that horn. That driver, that horn wasn't just to get out of the way. That was, if you even get out of your car and try and give me shit, it's on. Like, I'm going to kill you. That's where this is going. There's no escalation beyond that. It can't go to words. It's going to come to violence. That's what leaning on the horn means. It's like getting your weapons out. You know, and it's kind of sizing someone up. So I think a lot of people when they drive, they've got that mentality of, if you beep someone, you're basically saying, do you want to fight me? I'm going to beep you. You better fight me right now. Like, that's what a lot of people use.
Well, this is what I was thinking with the Swedish guy, but he was so fucking, like, psychopathically holding that horn down. Like, nothing you've ever seen in your life.
He wants the fight. That's the thing. He's beeping that he hopes the cabbie gets out and gives him shit so he can get out and there's a fucking fight in the street. Because they're on a fucking hair trigger, these guys. They're driving around all day and
they drive for a living.
Yeah, it's driving their
minds. People mad.
But it was such a moment, though. I honestly, like, just him... Because everyone on the bus sort of kind of cheered, right, after he finished. But also, we were terrified of him. It was almost like the fact that he was willing to hold down his horn for that long and be that disturbing to that many people at a busy crossing. You know,
Dude doesn't care.
And just attract that much attention to himself. It was like, what the fuck? What a big old fucking pair of shaved balls that guy had.
Sorry for the wait, ladies and gentlemen. We've finally arrived at our destination, Disneyland. I hope you all have a really nice time, and I'll see you next time.
Oh, it looks like someone is in our spot.
I want that noise as my car horn, actually, just you doing the impression.
So like that. Obnoxious. That, he wasn't even pressing the horn, that was him yelling out the window.
No. God. So if you haven't had the memo from that angry bus driver that he's going to be on the road today,
stay off. Stay
consider
safe.
This a warning. Don't stay safe. Don't drive. And God bless you. And we've been us. You've been you. And see you next time, I guess. Are we done?
Yeah that sounds done. Good for me.
We're
Thanks,
done.
Everyone. See you next time.
All right.
Adios.
Peace out, everybody.